Just occasionally, a truly world-class performer graces the world stage, and here now is a profile of one such man. With the qualities of searing pace, dedication, and unswerving loyalty to his teammates, it's Alan Donald. With 264 wickets at 21.66 already under his belt, and his name at the top of the list of the Price Waterhouse Coopers International Bowling Ratings, Alan Donald has already established himself as an all-time great. Yet he has needed to be patient in his quest for success. Along with so many South Africans, Donald had to wait until his country's readmission to international sport in 1992 to gain the worldwide recognition he craved. The World Cup in Australia presented the ideal stage, but the boys' own script still had some rough edges to it, as their first match against the hosts proved.
When we ran onto the field there and, you know, Jeff Marsh taking the first ball and nicked it straight to Dave Richardson, I was, you know, a lot of people was asking me how come I wasn't so angry. I was just so, I couldn't believe it was not out. You know, it was just so Kepler Vessels and everyone was so pumped up. It was like a rugby match out there. And just couldn't believe the pure disbelief of just he's nicked it almost to first slip and stood. And Dave Aldridge, the umpire from New Zealand, just said, look, I didn't hear a nick or saw a deflection. And, you know, his next ball was a big wide down the leg side, four wides. And then the nervousness crept in. I was just so, I couldn't let the ball go. And I think I picked up three wickets that game, 3 for 34. And I was so chuffed afterwards and just happy to have been in and settled in. I've played the first game. We beat Australia and now we thought we were going to beat the world, which clearly didn't do.
Although it took a controversial rain ruling to deny South Africa in the semi-final.
You know, we lost exactly 8 minutes. 8 minutes for rain when it stopped. The lights were on, it stopped, and when they went back on, it was, you know, we needed one hell of a shot to win the game, which was very, very disappointing. But we went back home as heroes, you know. Everybody thought we were hard done by, and rules were made, we accepted that. And but we still had a great return to international cricket, and you know, it was wonderful to go home. And that ticker tape parade through Johannesburg was just, we just won the World Cup. You know, it was wonderful. It was a great reception.
So the international careers of Donald and the likes of Rhodes, McMillan and Richardson were now well and truly launched. And throughout the 90s, South Africa have built consistently on that beginning. Donald's performances have, perhaps more than any, brought cricket in South Africa close to the popularity enjoyed by its rugby players. But as a child, rugby was still very definitely the game to play.
Rugby was my first love. There was no doubt about it. I loved rugby, and I ate and drank rugby. That was in our household, and that's in the South African, the people. You know, just rugby is, as well as in New Zealand, is huge.
It wasn't until Donald had entered his teens that he picked up the round ball for the first time.
I pitched up at a net session because, you know, the rugby season was finished. And I wanted to do something in the summer because, you know, since I was a kid, I've always been quite bored very easily, and, you know, nothing's changed since then. But I pitched up there and I started bowling leg spinners and played one or two games bowling leg spin. And then one day the teacher said he needed a fast bowler. You know, his main strike bowler's ill, and he wondered if I could do the job. And I thought, well, I'll give it a go. And bowled these big in swingers, and that was the start of me. And he just said, well, where have you been hiding all this time? I had no control over what I was doing. I had no idea where it was going, but I could bowl quick, you know. And on the day when I got it right, eventually I was as a school kid, I progressed from an under 13 to under 15, and from there, As a youngster, 14, I went into under 19s and represented SA schools when I was, about 16 years old.
But Alan's batting wasn't progressing quite so swiftly.
There was a stage when Alan took his batting very seriously in primary school and convinced the coach that it's time that he gets an opportunity to bat in the top three. And the coach eventually gave him a chance against the weakest opposition in Bloemfontein. And sort of first over, he looked at most of the balls, summed it up and left him alone outside of stump. And the coach said to him, well, you know, just get on with it a bit because we need to score some runs against these guys. And next over was the same thing. And the third over, he got sent off the field again. So that was the end of his batting chances.
I remember very well when I was sent off the field by my teacher. And I know that Hansie was playing in that same team, would vouch for that. And he was, I think I missed four balls in a row, and he said to me, look, you better not miss the next one because you're out of here, you're wasting my time. And he sent me off the field. I was deeply shocked, and as I walked off the field, I saw my father driving in, you know, from work to come and watch me. And I just burst into tears, you know, I couldn't believe what was happening.
Still, there was compensation for father and son when it was time to bowl.
I got eight wickets, and I was very frustrated. And it wasn't one of the best schools we played against at that time. It was like a practice game. I got 8 for 16, and it sort of made up for my miss out there.
And as the fast bowler blossomed, even the rugby began to suffer.
I was a fly half, and very well known for my kicking. I hardly passed the ball, but when I got in high school, I think I lost the plot a bit, and I started trying to emulate Naas Buerto. We never really passed the ball that much. So I was dropped. I think I played two games in the first team and at school, and when I was in my final year at school. And I think then I started to realise, well, maybe I'm drifting towards a cricket career, definitely.
In those days, it wasn't really possible to play cricket for a living unless you were prepared to go outside of South Africa. And the first time that he mentioned it was at the age of 18 or 19, just after school, when he was doing his military service in South Africa. He got the opportunity to go to Warwickshire. And he sort of came to my dad, who was then the president of Free State Cricket Union, and asked him for his advice. And he said, go over for 6 months and see what you think about it, you know, and then obviously you can assess it from then. I just thought to myself, geez, Alan, this is a big step, you know. Number one, you're going to struggle there because you can't speak a word of English.
It was a huge problem. I, young Afrikaner boy, young Afrikaner spotty boy, came into this dressing room downstairs and just looked around me. And the first person that grabbed me was Jeff Humpage. And he sat me down. And I changed next to him that whole season. And he was good to me. He was really good. I even travelled with him on away trips, and we talked cricket. And that's all I wanted to hear, you know, what people did and what these great players are like. But I had to learn English. And when I went back that year, I could speak English. I even went back with an English accent, which I quickly had to can some way.
Number two, cricket is not really paying that much. You know, it's not worth your while.
I had thoughts about being a successful cricketer and making money out of the game, which my parents didn't actually believe. But and then it happened. I was here in 1987, and it was a real eye-opener.
Number three, you've got to be really, really good to make it. And I wasn't convinced whether he was going to make it. Nobody knew, you know, exactly how good he was, because he'd only played at school level at that stage.
You left South Africa and proceeded a career in England with Warwickshire. And we kind of just kept getting the news back that he was getting better, faster. And then suddenly he was there and he played against the rebel sides.
You know, I was playing 6 months here and 6 months in South Africa. But my cricket in South Africa suffered a lot. I think I was trying so hard here. The volume of cricket that we played here was a lot. You know, it was something like 23 games. And then when I went back home, I was heavily criticised for saying that I was not trying for my province, Free State. Because county cricket's now taken priority, first priority, and I felt deeply sort of hurt by that, and I just felt tired. I really did. I probably didn't know it, but I was really knackered, and my form suffered. So I just started on a new campaign, which was a fitness and getting strong campaign, and that had to be the thing.
So an intensive fitness regime was established, whilst at the same time an improved mental approach was gradually fostered.
Clive Rice used to just said to me one day that he looked at me and said, look, you've got to do that, you've got to get strong, you've got to get fit, and you will do that one day. But he just said to me that I've got to go and enjoy my cricket. Don't feel that you've got to do, when you go out there, you'll never get to be successful if you don't enjoy it.
And here you've got this gangly boy from the Free State, could hardly speak English, but was quick and certainly had immense potential. And he came into the side and just, you know, you wondered, suddenly people coming from an Afrikaans environment, how you get them focused on what's happening in the so-called English English cricketing environment. And with Alan, you know, I just said to him, you know, you come out here and you enjoy it, because we're going out there and we're going to have a lot of fun. There's going to be heartache, but you don't have to worry about that. If you enjoy what you're doing, you're going to be very pleasantly surprised as to how you perform on the field.
But what Donald desperately wanted was an international stage on which to perform. And his time in England provided a distant opportunity.
Because then there was also, in those days, there were rumours that South Africa will get back into Test cricket. And I didn't believe that. I really didn't. You know, and I wanted to do exactly what Robin Smith and his brother did, and Alan Lamb. I wanted to come over here and I wanted to play. I wanted to represent a country. You know, I didn't know what was going on politically in my own country. So I just thought, well, this is the only way out. I wanted to play cricket. I wanted to be my career. And Dr. Bach just said, look, in 2 years' time, we'll play Test cricket. We'll go to the next World Cup. 92, we'll go to the next World Cup. And as true as his word, we were there.
And the rest, as they say, is history.
If South Africa thought their disappointing exit from the 1992 World Cup in Australia would be good preparation for the hard knocks of Test cricket, that resolve was immediately tested when they took on the West Indies in Barbados a month later. It was their first test since readmission, but a stunning last-day performance from Kirtley Ambrose and Courtney Walsh propelled the West Indies to an unlikely 52-run win.
That was just an awesome display of quick bowling. You know, there we were losing a test match and we've actually got it in our hands. We've actually winning it, but we've absolutely just thrown it away. And we panicked and got blown away by two great bowlers. So we knew what to expect, and then we got the taste of test cricket, and Kepler said that if we're going to have to win, we have to toughen up, you know, take more responsibility.
Yet for a young Alan Donald, the heroics of Ambrose and Walsh provided a benchmark to measure his own performances.
I knew then that the standard that those guys have set is enormous, and that's the responsibility they took that day to become great bowlers. And I knew that one day I wanted to be a leader for my side as well. I want to take that responsibility in my hands and say, right, I'm going to bowl you out.
That moment was not long in coming, and 8 months later, it was Donald with match figures of 12 for 139 who was bowling his country to victory against India at St George's Park, Port Elizabeth.
I think I got five in the first and seven in the second innings, and I've always done very well there for some reason. I don't know, some bowlers have grounds where they just pitch up and take wickets. And that ground to me is a great ground for me.
1 year later and a much closer triumph against Australia at the SCG. The Aussies needed just 117 second innings runs to win.
The best game I've ever played in was that one. The best test match, that was no doubt about it. It was most tense. I don't think we felt it as much as Glenn McGrath did. But in a way, I felt quite sorry for him, but one by five runs, you know, is something really, really... Because Kepler said that evening that we'll beat these guys tomorrow. The runs we scored there is enough. And Jonty even said to me, while I was batting with him, he said, 116 is enough on that wicket. The wicket's shocking. And it was, actually. It was very uneven, very slow, very hard to get away. And Mark Waugh, the previous evening, said to Hansi Coronia, why don't you just give us the game so we can go home? Why don't you just put a few pie throwers on, you know, and get it over with? But I think they quietly felt that it's going to be difficult. It's going to be difficult trying to get these runs. We already had them four down by then. They were about 40 odd for four. And Alan Border was out second ball of the day. And then Mark Waugh, and it just got tighter and tighter. And then the man who played the best innings was Craig McDermott. You know, he came in and just smashed it. And we thought, oh dear, it's slipping away again here.
And McDermott has decided to do the right thing. Get some boundaries and bring that tally down quickly. That's good thinking.
McDermott and Damien Martin are playing very well.
Got him. Yes, straight to cover. That's it. Damien Martin has gone for the drive. He's hit it straight to cover. And the South Africans are all over each other. Well, Glenn McGrath is going to have to make his way to the centre now with 10 minutes to go before lunch.
And he made a mistake, I think, taking the strike or getting Glenn McGrath on strike with two balls to go in the over.
Oh, got him! South Africa have got it. They've won. Straight back to him. Caught and bowled. What a game for de Villiers.
Well, what a game. What a game. I've never seen a side so distraught.
McGrath is not moving. He's standing at the crease, so disappointed, and the South Africans are over the moon.
That match pitted together, as opposing captains, the two toughest cricketers Donald has encountered.
I would say if you have to put Alan Border and Kepler Wessels together, they'd make... they'd die for your country. I think Alan Border is... he's a tough man. He really is a tough man. You don't get any tougher than that. And Kepler Wessels... to play with him is something else. You know, he'd be very hard on you if he didn't do what he tell you to do. But also he'd show his emotion sometimes, which probably wasn't the right thing to do at certain stages. But he just wanted the best out of his players. And sometimes I thought he just went it around it a little bit the other way.
The 1994 tour of England was to be Wessels' last, and the third test defeat at the hands of an inspired Devon Malcolm was a bitter pill to swallow.
When we lost at the Oval, I think that really... I don't think I've seen a man that disappointed in a long time. I think that really hurt him a lot. he was certainly he was mad. He just wanted to get on the next plane out. And things weren't quite in the South African camp. Things weren't quite all that rosy, you know. There was a lot of little things that started to go wrong, and you know, something had to be done quickly. You know, and then obviously it was the end of Mike Proctor, and Kepler Wessels was out of there, and Hansie was the captain. The start of Bob Woolmer's reign, and you know, but since then we've slowly just built up and became a much better side.
Under Woolmer and Cronje, South Africa's star continued to rise, and although a series win against Australia has eluded them, the 1-0 success against Pakistan in Pakistan must rate as the highlight so far. It was Donald who took the vital winning catch.
Moin Khan, I think, went on the sweep, and I think my hands went numb when that thing was in the air. I just saw it coming towards me, and my hands just went numb, and it just melted in, thank goodness. I don't think I've ever run as quickly as that to try and get to Pat Simcox, who was lying on the wicket there doing some kind of a dance or something, and all the players were on him. And it was a great achievement to beat Pakistan, and Pakistan was a good effort.
Last summer's series against England ended in disappointment, but Donald's unceasing efforts earned him the Man of the Series award. His second innings duel at Trent Bridge with Mike Atherton is now viewed as a modern classic.
I remember saying to Hansie when I came back, I said, this is going to be a big spell, you know, something's got to happen here. And the first ball I bowled in that spell, I felt just right. I said, oh, that felt good. And I bowled the whole over the wicket. And then the next over, I bowled another ball, and I said to Steve Dunn, I'll come round the wicket. And then it happened.
Ah, that's a very good catch, I suspect, off the glove.
As I ran through, you know, I was so convinced it was out. As I ran through, I just saw the slip stood still and looked at the umpire in disbelief. And I turned around, I knew, well, he didn't give it out.
Well, Donald is enormously disappointed on this one.
Well, I wanted to kick all six stumps out of the ground first. And then maybe stab him with it or something. But I knew then that on our way back, I just said to Athers that he better brace himself now. He thought that I was speaking in Afrikaans, but I wasn't actually. I actually told him that he better brace himself now, because what is about to happen I've got no control over. And I said to him a few times, and he just looked at me. He just stared at me and never said a word. That was probably one of the quickest I bowled, definitely. One of the most intense. I didn't even hear the crowd. I was so focused on what is in on the other end. And I could hear the odd boo. And one thing that settled me down is that my kids were at fine leg. And I actually sat down there and I chatted to them and just switched off. And 8 overs. I don't think I've ever been that tired. I had adrenaline. I could bowl 15 overs on the trot at that stage. But it just took a lot out of me, you know, bowling short ball after short ball and trying as hard to bowl as quickly as possible, just concentrating as hard as possible. Just took everything. And I think the next morning I was quite stuffed.
England have won by 8 wickets, and it's a stirring victory.
South Africa got over that low point by whitewashing the West Indies 5-0. Donald took 23 wickets in that series and is now only 35 shy of joining the elite 300 club.
If I can do it in 7 test matches, that would be really nice. You know, we've got 2 against Zimbabwe, home and away, and then 5 against England in November, December, January, February in South Africa. I think that could well be the grudge series. I think it still hurts, it really does, you know, having lost here, and the South African public weren't kind to us in a way. So I think we'd be looking to put that right.
But it looks like further test landmarks are out of the question.
Right now, my children and my family now takes time, and I think it's time that I give some time back to them. So if I can get that goal within the space of time, I think that will probably, well, I don't know, that probably might be it. After that, you know, I'd like to be available for Warwickshire, come play here for a couple more years and maybe for Free State and enjoy my cricket. And being involved with the coaching over here, would, you know, I'd like to give back something to them as well. And also for South African cricket. And I'm already on their specialist bowling panel and see what I can offer for them or what they can offer for me in the future to come. So, you know, I definitely want to be involved in the game. That is for sure. I think it's in every cricketer's blood to be involved in that, and that's certainly my idea.
Such a popular cricketer, Alan Donald. Hope you enjoyed part two of our profile of White Lightning of both Warwickshire and South Africa. Donald.